Hi friends, welcome back to another episode of Generation Films. My name is Alan. Mass production is a very human solution for many of the larger problems we face in society today. Mass production cuts costs by increasing the scale of their operation, providing cheaper goods at faster speeds. The American Dream in the 1950s featured two cars in the driveway and a fridge in the kitchen and TV in the living room. And this was all bought to the American consumer by the modern marvel of mass production. But decades of uncapped industrial expansion has brought out the terrible side of this type of manufacturing. Instead of just making for order, mass production simply guesses what the market will want, leading to massive amounts of waste and overproduction. And despite a massive awakening in our collective consciousness over the detrimental effects this has on our future and the planet, the benefits of mass production are unavoidable because humans crave progress and expansion. We are an optimistic species that believes that we can engineer and create our way out of any problem. But what if one day we took our fascination with mass production and applied it to ourselves? Who says the automation of the more mundane tasks in life has to be done by a machine or an algorithm? The human brain has proven to be incredibly hard to replicate in a synthetic way. The human brain is really one of the most valuable commodities ever created here on Earth, and perhaps even in the galaxy. Imagine what we can do as a species if we could just learn how to replicate it in a safe and efficient way through cloning. Today, I thought it'd be interesting to look at five clone armies and the ethical, logistical, and scientific hurdles they had to go through in order to be created. The Centaurans were a race of extremely proud and militaristic warriors. They hailed from the planet of Sontar, home of the Katvich. The Katvich were attacked by the Rutan Horde, a race of amorphous green blobs who could survive in vacuum and shoot out powerful arcs of electricity. The Katvich were losing ground to the Rutan Horde and they needed to quickly replenish their casualties, so they started cloning themselves. Which is when the Centaurans were created. Built apparently to precise warrior specifications, the Centaurans possessed no-nonsense military first-type personalities and pursued war and greatly enjoyed death and destruction. The Centaurans weren't necessarily evil, they were just really enthusiastic and good at their job. Also, their home planet had 6 times the gravity as Earth. This meant Centaurans were physically quite tough and very dense compared to most species. Unfortunately for the Katvich, the Centaurans would basically replace them on their home planet. The Galactic Republic in many ways is a larger scale version of a representative democracy we see here on Earth. It features a constitution which grants basic rights to every species in the galaxy. You know, protection from persecution, harming, and glassing from orbit. It also has a relatively robust and free media, along with checks and balances within the government structure. Until the Separatist crisis started the Clone Wars, it was generally frowned upon to use a massive clone workforce. It was acceptable in the Outer Rim and more remote areas where large corporate entities ran mining operations. But when the Clone Wars started abruptly with the revelation that the Separatist Alliance had a massive droid army, the Republic was thrown into shock and panic. It needed a quick show of force to maintain stability in the galaxy. The big problem was the Republic had demilitarized almost 1,000 years ago, and now they relied on a very decentralized network of planetary defense forces and system defense forces. This saved the Republic untold amounts of money, but local defense forces rarely want to leave their homes. It was this very particular political climate that allowed for the immediate approval of a clone army that appeared literally out of thin air. You see, decades earlier, two Sith Lords had started a very ingenious plan to basically take over the galaxy with this clone army, which they implanted with control chips in their brains. They had privately funded the entire process themselves, which must have cost a ridiculous amount of money. We're not just talking about the cloning process, but feeding, training, and housing these clones until they became full adults, and then equipping them with basic weapons, armor, and vehicles. It's a huge amount of money, but still attainable thanks to the Republic's embrace of free market economics and its very plentiful special trade zones in the Outer Rim. So the citizens of the Republic never really got a chance to discuss the ethics of this cloning program. There was never an inquiry on whether the Republic could support the maintenance of such a massive military program or what would happen to these clones when they are retired or can no longer fight. Even though these mysterious donors have bought the army, someone still has to pay for all of the logistics and maintenance. The clone army would continue to grow throughout the course of the 4 years of the Clone War until it reached such a massive size that the federal government had no choice but to nationalize the banks and print more credits to sustain it. As far as these individual clone troopers, though, they were remarkable. Bred from the DNA of a famous bounty hunter, their personality was altered at a genetic and conditioning level, making them some of the best soldiers in the galaxy. They were fearless and completely loyal to their officers and spent their entire lives training for war. It should be noted that they did age twice as quick as a normal human being. This allowed for faster production, but also shorter service. Now, the type of Apple Store cloning we see on Kamino is a very perfected method of cloning, but that's not always going to happen. Cloning is a ridiculously difficult science to master. When they created Dolly the sheep, she was one success out of 277 attempts. So it's not surprising that not every clone army is going to get this right. In the Warframe universe, Earth is overrun by mutated jungles. Humans have long abandoned the surface of their homeworld due to the toxicity of the atmosphere. In our place, a group known as the Greener have taken over. They are a heavily militarized empire which is entirely made up of genetically modified purpose-bred clones of humanity. There is no natural birth for the Greener. Every one of their members comes out mass-produced alongside their weapons and armor. The only issue is the Greener first gained the knowledge of cloning from a long-lost faction known as the Orokin. And all the genetic templates actually come from this long ancient race, but after many, many generations of cloning the same material, the quality of the clones was rapidly falling. As a matter of fact, all Greener are born with a wide array of physical deformities and also mental issues, which meant that in general, the Greener lived only a fraction of a full human lifespan. This is why every Greener is heavily supported by cybernetic prosthetics and other intrusive augmentations. Ironically, the Greener actually became masters of sustaining life because of these terrible ailments they were born with. We're quickly approaching the era of rich corporate overlords who can essentially do anything they want without much constraint from the government. In the world of Endless Space, the Horatio faction is a perfect example of what can happen when one crazy rich person has access to limitless resources. Horatio, by the way, is not just the name of the faction, it's also the name of the person who started the faction. You see, one day Horatio left the Mazari Empire with his trillions and sought a star cluster he could claim as his own. When Horatio landed on this new world, he encountered an ancient endless rune. The endless are kind of like this precursor race with all sorts of crazy technology and runes they've left scattered across the galaxy. The runes that Horatio finds are loaded with extremely advanced cloning pods. Like any real rich individual who has everything in the world, Horatio soon becomes bored and lonely and starts cloning himself. After all, there is no one more beautiful in the galaxy than Horatio, and Horatio's gift to the galaxy would be to fill it with himself. Eventually, Horatio would repopulate the planet, which was now called Horatio Prime, with millions of clones. And soon, the Horatio faction began spreading to other neighboring systems. The Horatio faction, despite its strange makeup, still has a normal social structure. The only difference was the variation between individuals was minute and limited to facial tattoos. Defective clones that looked a bit too different were destroyed, and also all of Horatio's clones adopted their founder's confidence and also disdain for other species, so they kind of had an elitist view of the galaxy. Last up is also my most likely to happen at the end of 2020 scenario. Because the Australian forest fire in hindsight wasn't as bad as COVID, which in hindsight wasn't as bad as the curfew and riots, which in hindsight probably won't be as bad as the crazy hurricane season we're about to have, which honestly in hindsight isn't going to be as bad as when aliens invade Earth with an entire army of Tom Cruises. Yes, this is the backstory for Oblivion, and it is so perfect for 2020. Jack Harper, not to be confused with Jack Reacher or Jack, is in command of NASA's Odyssey mission to Titan, the largest moon of Saturn. On his way back to Earth, their mission is redirected to investigate an abnormal object in space, which happens to be TET, a very malicious artificial intelligence that roams the galaxy sucking up resources and planets. TET seizes Tom Cruise and then clones endless copies of him and uses an army of Tom Cruise to take over Earth. Unfortunately, we don't get to see this actually happen in the film, but I would definitely pay to see that prequel movie. So there you have it, guys. 5 very different clone armies built for 5 very different reasons. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that notification button so you don't miss out on the rest of our awesome content. As usual, thanks for joining us today. My name is Alan, reminding you that life is a movie and you are the protagonist.